Hey everybody, it is January 3rd, 2022. Happy New Year to you all. Now, let's go photograph a meteor shower. Hey guys, what's up? It's Chris Pearson with NebuloCity, the very first video here in 2022, and I'm super excited to get started with my very first meteor shower. Here in the Northern Hemisphere, we are very fortunate to have the Quadrantids meteor shower peak in the days of January 2nd and 3rd of each year. And the Quadrantids are a very special sort of meteor shower for a couple of reasons. First and foremost, they're named after a constellation that no longer exists. Quadrans Mirales was a constellation back in the 1700s, 1800s that was more or less done away with by the International Astronomical Union when they decided on sort of the modern 88 constellations that we know today. The other reason why it's a particularly special object or series of objects, these meteors, is because there's such a narrow window of opportunity to photograph them. In fact, it's just a couple of hours. That pales in comparison to some of the other big meteor showers that we have on an annual basis, such as the Perseids or the Geminids, which could be over several days and nights. Another special element to these meteors is that they are a bit more faint than other meteor showers. So it's really critical that if you're going to shoot them, you try to get out to a darker site. Now, I don't do that a whole lot here on NebuloCity as I shoot from the city, but in this case, I'm moving from my Bortle 8-9 skies out to a Bortle 5 location to try and give myself the best possible chance to be successful on this shoot. So I definitely recommend you do the same. Bortle 5 or darker is the way to go. Now, speaking of preparation, when shooting meteor showers, it's really critical that you have a few important pieces of equipment on hand so that you're successful in capturing the data, not only for the imaging session, but for post-process editing as well. Starting with the camera, you can use something lying around the house as simple as a digital camera, a DSLR. I'll be using my Canon EOS 80D that I'm filming this particular episode with. It's got an APS-C crop sensor in there, very similar to my dedicated astronomy cameras. And it, you know, it's very sensitive. It can take in the light. Again, as long as you're in a dark site location, it should be able to pick that up. We'll talk a little bit later about settings and things of that nature, but a DSLR is the first main piece of equipment that you want. The second important piece of equipment, perhaps arguably the most important, is your camera lens. So in this case, I'll be using the Samyang f2.8 14mm that is made by Samyang in Korea, which also produces the Rokinon camera lenses. Now 14mm, why so short of a focal length? Because the shorter focal length will give you a much wider field of view. And that's really important. If you've ever been out to a meteor shower or a star party, you know, you lay back on your back and you look up to the sky because you want as wide a view as possible. Those meteors can be streaking in from any direction. The third piece of equipment is the intervalometer. Now, this little guy I purchased off of Amazon a couple of years ago, and essentially it's a remote shutter release cable. So it enables you to set the number of exposures, the minimum time or interval between exposures, which you want to essentially be zero so that you're continuously shooting and not missing a comet. I'm sorry, not missing an not missing a meteor. Third time's a charm there. But you want it set to zero. It allows you to set the exposure time. There's all kinds of things that that intervalometer can do. Some cameras have those things built in, but I like the intervalometer. It gives me a little bit more flexibility in doing that, you know, remotely. So that brings me to my fourth recommendation, which is batteries. Depending on the meteor shower, you know, you want to make sure you don't have just one, but perhaps two batteries with you, especially in the cold evenings of January. Batteries die very quickly. So bring a couple of extra batteries with you if you've got them, just in case you need them. Beyond that, there are a couple of other things that I would recommend having with you as well. I would say, you know, some tape, duct tape. I've got some painter's tape. That's important because when you go into focus in on the stars, that you've got a good focus, you don't want that focus ring to really tilt and adjust too much. So a roll of tape is really critical, you know, for keeping that from moving around. You may also want to bring some sort of lens duster or an air bulb that you can use to blow off the dust of your camera lens just to make sure there are no artifacts or anything on the front end of the lens before you start your shoot. That's pretty critical. Another important piece of equipment is your tripod. You want to make sure that you can mount that camera and kit lens on top of a sturdy tripod that you're able to sort of angle in different directions in order to capture as much of these as you can. Now, in my case, I purchased about a year and a half ago this newer carbon fiber, you know, tripod with a ball head to be able to mount this camera on, and it works really well. It's super lightweight, it's sturdy, but there are a whole, you know, myriad of tripod options on the market. You can sort of get the one that works best for you. As long as it's sturdy and isn't gonna bounce around, that's the most important thing. Now, one of the last major pieces of equipment that I'd recommend you have is a dew heater strap. Dew builds up, or moisture builds up, on these lenses very quickly out in the open air. You know, the lens and the air temperature vary. One is warmer than the other, and that difference in temperature variations creates that dew on the front of the lens itself. And that's really gonna make it difficult for you to capture anything at all. And you don't wanna ruin your session simply on the count of dew. And then, you know, make sure you've got a good power source that you can plug into. In this case, I've got a solar sort of brick battery pack that I use, and it lasts for a good 3 to 4 hours, so should be fine. Now, one of the major elements that you need to factor into your project if you're shooting meteors is the exposure time. In order to determine the correct exposure time for your camera and your optics, your lens, you're going to need to use one of two general rules, either the 500 rule or the 300 rule. Now, the 500 rule is for full frame cameras. The 300 rule is for APS-C crop sensor cameras like my Canon EOS 80D. So let's go with the 300. The way it works is you take the number 300 and you divide that by the focal length of your lens. In this case, the Samyang 14 millimeter. So if we divide 300 by 14, we get just over 21. So just over 21 seconds before you start to see things like star trails, the elongation of stars, not what you want in your final image. So that's pretty much it for the pre-shoot narrative. You know, we're gonna go ahead out there later this evening into the wee morning hours to try to capture these meteors. We'll try to take some of this data that we acquire and turn it into a final image. So stay tuned.